second to last night here of our lecture series on Bible prophecy. I hope that you all have been blessed so far. We've got a couple of new faces here, so I'll just introduce myself. My name is Michael Brown. I've been your host throughout this series of lectures, and I, by God's grace, will continue to be your host if everything goes okay. And quick notice, if you need a bathroom, just head down the stairs out here in the foyer, follow the hallway until you see the water fountain on your right-hand side, and there's a couple of bathrooms right there. Also, we do have the children's program going on next door, so if anybody's got kids that's coming, make sure that they know about that. It'd be a great opportunity for the children. And we're going to open tonight with a short prayer, and then we will have our theme song. Father, we want to thank you tonight that you've promised that anybody that desires to know the truth about your teaching, Lord, that it will be clear to them. And so, Lord, we thank you that through your Holy Spirit that you bring truth to our minds and our hearts. And, Lord, we just want to be open to that tonight. Lord, I know that I've had a lot of preconceived ideas in my past, and I'm sure I have some still that I need to let go of. And, Lord, I want to ask that you would reveal those to me and help me to let go of them. And I just thank you, Father, for this wonderful group of people. I pray that you would bless us tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Tia and Randy.
Bye.
We want God's light to shine on us. We want to be saved and have life. And this song just says it so well. How many of you are really getting to know this song? Yeah, well, after tonight, just one more night. So you guys can have it for tomorrow, right?
Thank you.
Pencils in hand, papers in hand. Time for our quiz.
Uh-oh.
Uh-oh. What does that mean? No pencils, no paper? Question number one. There are two sanctuaries mentioned all through the Bible. One was made by Moses in Israel on earth. Where is the other sanctuary? Remember, write them down. Don't call them out loud. We don't want to give it away to all our neighbors. But it is open book, so open your Bible if you know where it is. Extra brownie points if you get the scripture reference that tells you. All right, question number two. I can give out brownie points because my last name is Brown. So. Fair. Question number two. According to the Bible prophecy, is there a judgment before Jesus comes? Is there a judgment before Jesus comes? Yes or no? Question three. Whose righteousness vindicates us in the judgment? Whose righteousness vindicates us in the judgment? Question number four. True or false, the Antichrist has tried to change God's times and laws. True or false? Question number five. What is our role in this cosmic judgment? What is our role in this cosmic judgment? That's a challenging one.
It is.
All right. Back to question one. There are two sanctuaries mentioned. One made by Moses in Israel. Where is the other sanctuary?
Heaven.
In heaven. There's a heavenly sanctuary, of which the earthly is just a mere pattern. Amen. Question number two. According to Bible prophecy, is there a judgment before Jesus comes?
Yes.
Yes. We learned about that a little bit the other night, right? Daniel chapter 7 talks about that judgment. Question number three. Whose righteousness vindicates us in the judgment? Jesus, right? Because what's our righteousness? Like filthy rags. What? I want Jesus' righteousness.
Amen.
Question number four, true or false, the Antichrist has tried to change God's times and laws.
True.
It's true. We read that the other night too. Excellent. Question number five, what is our role in this cosmic judgment?
Be on one side or the
other. Be on one side or the other? Share the gospel. Be a demonstration of the gospel. I like that. Amen. Any other thoughts? Yeah, I think that really nails it in a sense, you know, that to be a witness to God's true character. Because, you know, God is being judged. There's been a lot of slander against God, a lot of lies that have been told about him. And he needs a people that will be able to show what's really true about who he is.
Amen.
You know? Amen. All right. We are going to collect up all those quizzes so we can do our book handout tonight. And I left that book over here somewhere, so I'm going to try and recover it. Here we go. Hold them up high so Jackie knows where to go to get those. Don't let me go. Excellent. Do we have all the quizzes? No stragglers? All right. Did you put one in there? No, me either. So I guess we're out. Shall I do the honors? All right. We know it's not John, because we just got here. All right. Kathy and Arthur Jones. Oh, boy. Excellent. our next one here. Let's see.
Evelyn
Safety. Oh, okay. Excellent. All right. Two tonight. I'll let you pass them in as you deem worthy. Excellent. All right. Thank you all for participating in that. Now time for our question and answers. So the question tonight, we were talking about the judgment last night, Daniel chapter 7. I think this is a wonderful question. It says, how can I be sure that God will accept me during this judgment? I sometimes feel so unworthy. So how can we be sure that God's going to accept us in the judgment? So if you have your Bibles and you'd like to turn with me, turn to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We want to find out what God says about how we can be accepted and how we can be okay through this judgment. 1 John, not the Gospel of John, but the one that's close to the end of the Bible, 1 John. Chapter 2. And verse 1. And it says, my little children, these things I write to you, so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And we see the righteousness of Christ there, and we also see that Jesus is our advocate. You know, he's our elder brother. He's one of us. It's amazing. And Jesus is advocating for us. He's drawing us to put our trust in him. Now, if you go a little bit further in your Bible to the right, right before the book of Revelation, Jude 24 also has something to tell us. Only one chapter in Jude, the 24th verse. And this is just a beautiful promise from God to us. Jude verse 24 says, now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. That's what God wants to do for us. Present us faultless. And we can only have that through a surrendered relationship with Jesus. Letting him be in control, letting him be all in all. He's all that we need, folks.
Amen.
If you have Jesus, you have everything.
Amen.
So I'm excited about that.
Amen.
Amen. And at this time, we're going to go into our special music. I don't quite know how to introduce this special music because I'm a part of it. So, and we don't have a group name yet, but it's the men's trio. So I hope you enjoy it. 3 months before we've been up 3 months here. Give us just a moment to get set up. I have the easy part here. And is David back there? Can he unmute the pulpit mic?
Sorry, but you guys figure it out.
Number one, I think.
One.
Testing, testing. Yeah, that's good. Thanks, Jack. Oh, you're muted too? You know. Six, five.
Six.
Five? Five, six?
No, it's three.
Three. One. We're going to get started.
Good? I need you.
There's
Kate. Then I was trying for you. I got number one down.
Just unmute them all.
There.
Oh, there you go. Nice.
Thank you.
those of you just joining us tonight, I want to welcome Pastor Rick Kuntz to come up here. He's going to be sharing our lecture with us tonight, and we're just going to open with a word of prayer. Father, we just come to you, Lord, beggars, looking for heavenly bread. Lord, we pray that you give us bread tonight to share. Lord, we know that we can't share bread if we're not at the table. So, Lord, we have been at the table with you. And Lord, we ask now for your Holy Spirit to come to sharpen each one of our minds, our hearts. We thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Good to see each one of you tonight. I'm looking forward to our time together. And I'm thankful for the privilege of studying the Bible in a place that's at peace. We're very blessed people. We do not appreciate the Bible in this country. It just pains me to see how little value we place on this book. And I hope and pray during this seminar the Lord has really been stirring your heart to want to study more. Because God's got a more sure word of prophecy that's very important. Now our seminar is winding down. Tomorrow night is our last night of this short little series, God's Final Remnant. We're going to be studying tomorrow night on the seal of God. The most important thing in Bible prophecy is having the seal of God. Those are the only ones who won't be deceived at the end of time. We're going to study that subject. It's very, very clear tomorrow night. I'm going to start a follow-up every Wednesday night for those of you who want to study at a more leisurely pace what we've been studying here. I know I've been covering a lot of ground, and for some of you, a lot of it's very new. I know it's very intense, but I want to plead with you. We need to know for ourselves from the Bible what the issues are. Too many people, especially in churches today, are just following people and books that have a few Bible verses sprinkled in, but they're not based on truth. So I really want to encourage you, if you're really serious about understanding, Wednesday nights, every Wednesday night, I'm starting a class at 6:30 on these studies. Now, I invite you to turn as we begin tonight. Our subject tonight, American prophecy, is a very powerful subject. But I want us to start in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4, because I'm going to be covering some things here tonight that may be offensive to some of you. And, you know, unfortunately, political correctness is not just in the political world, it's also in the religious world. And I beg your forgiveness if you feel that I offend you tonight. It's my desire to present the Word of God clearly, humbly, so people can hear it for themselves and do their own thinking and make up their own minds. I'm not trying to get anybody to take my word for anything, but I'm pleading with you to study the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12 makes a profound statement about the Bible. Okay? Hebrews 4 and verse 12. The Bible says, Hebrews 4:12, for the word of God is quick. That's in the old King James. That Greek word actually means alive. It's living. Okay? This is God in print, the Bible. And by the way, no church owns the Bible. The Bible is preserved by God for every person who is willing to study and read it. So the Bible says the word of God is living. It's a living revelation of God. And it's powerful, it's life-changing when we yield to the Word of God, when we receive the Word of God into our heart by faith. It's living, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Now that's quite a statement in one verse, isn't it? According to God, the Bible is God's sword to pierce down into our hearts to reveal to us who He is, but also who we are. And sometimes that's painful. Sometimes the Word of God touches on something in our personal lives that challenges us. And sometimes it's painful. As Michael shared earlier, I've had a similar experience in my years studying the Bible. There's been hundreds and hundreds of times and that's not an exaggeration, and as I've studied the Word of God, that God has convicted me of something in my own heart that was not in harmony with Him. Now, I had an awesome decision to make. Was I just going to play church and, you know, go ahead and let people think or try to make people think that I was a nice guy? Or was I going to be a real Christian and surrender my heart unreservedly to the truth of God's Word, right? Now, I don't know about you, but I can't play church. I have no desire to be in church just, you know, trying to be a nice person. I can't be a nice person apart from Jesus anyway, but either I'm going to be all in for Jesus or I'm not, folks. Amen. And the greatest curse in the world today is lukewarm Christians. And Jesus deals with that in Revelation chapter 3. He doesn't condemn lukewarm Christians, but he says it's an issue. It's a problem because Jesus is not being clearly revealed to the Muslims, the Hindus, the Buddhists, and the atheists, and everybody else. So God wants us to be hot. That's what Jesus says. He wants us to be hot. So we're going to be covering some stuff tonight that's going to be very challenging. And I hope and pray that if you're offended, that you will study the Word of God like never before and ask God to show you the truth. Because that's what we need. If there's ever a time we need a truth, it's now, folks. And I don't know about you, but I do not want to believe a lie. I don't want to be in that group that Jesus described in Matthew chapter 7 when Jesus comes and say, Lord, Lord, I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons in your name. I did many wonderful works in your name. And what is Jesus going to say to them? I never knew you. I don't want to be in that group. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So, we're going to do a quick review here. We've been studying some beautiful prophecies. There's a lot of depth here. And we found that evil began in a perfect environment in God's own presence. We studied about that dragon in Revelation chapter 12. And who did we find out the dragon was?
Satan.
Now, did I make that up?
No.
No, we found it right from the Bible, right? And that dragon has a tail. And what did we find out that tail represents?
Lies.
Okay, we saw that in Isaiah 9, verse 15, right? Satan is brilliant about spinning lies that mingle truth and error to deceive people. We don't want to be deceived. We went back in the Bible and we saw that in the beginning he was not the dragon or the devil, but his name was Lucifer, and he was God's covering cherubim. Remember that. And as we saw in Exodus chapter 25, the cherubims, two of them over the mercy seat, that's all right there in the Bible, over the Ark of the Testament. And so it was Lucifer's responsibility to be in God's presence and learn from God and internalize that truth and then share it. His privilege was to guard the government of God, and you might say it was Lucifer's privilege to guard God's back, have God's back. But we saw the sad, sad story, didn't we, of how Satan, with the freedom of thought that God gave all of his creation, began to use his freedom of thought to develop a new theology, a new way of thinking, that instead of God being the center of the universe, himself was the center of the universe. He wanted to be worshipped as God. He brought this principle in. The mystery of iniquity is right there. Self-exaltation. You see, God's character of love is self-sacrificing love. Our Creator creates to serve, to minister to. But when Lucifer brought that new element into the universe, it brought chaos. Sometimes people say, well, why didn't God wipe out Lucifer? It's pretty simple. Because everyone in the universe was stunned. They didn't know what to think. God's light bearer now was slandering God, and they didn't know. And so God knew evil needed time to develop for everyone to make their own decision, who they wanted to serve. We saw that Lucifer infected Adam and Eve, and when Adam and Eve sinned, they were under the full control of that same self-exaltating spirit. And God didn't tell him to do good or do better or try harder. He made a promise in Genesis. And what was that promise? He was going to put enmity between Satan's seed and the woman's seed, and the woman's seed would come and crush Satan's head. Praise the Lord. And we've studied together in this short little series. That seed was none other than who?
Jesus.
God became flesh. Jesus has always existed in eternity past. But in order to crush Satan's head, he became one of us. And he was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. Praise the Lord. He conquered Satan in every way. Every time Satan tempted him, he put to death by depending on the Holy Spirit, by depending on God and his humanity, he put to death those temptations. He developed a perfect character, and then he went to the cross and he died our death. The death we deserved is eternal death. He died our death on that cross. His humanity experienced our eternal death. But he didn't stay in that grave, praise the Lord. He was raised on the third day. And when he went to heaven, what did he become as he went to heaven? Our high priest. Praise the Lord. Our mediator. So we could experience his life. Beautiful, beautiful work of Jesus. And as we studied last night, Jesus is in his final work as priest. By the way, in Zechariah chapter 6 and verse 13, the Bible says that he, right now, is a priest upon his throne. He's not a king upon his throne right now, although he deserves to be king of kings. But he's a priest. Why? He's interceding, trying to save any soul that is willing to be saved. And we studied that the next thing, when Jesus finishes his intercession, he is coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So before Jesus comes back, his work of priestly ministry will be finished. The door of probation will close forever for all people. Wow. We're living in a very, very solemn time right now. And so we recognize that as we're studying, we began last night studying the seed of the serpent. We've studied the seed of the woman, Jesus. We're studying the seed of the serpent. So turn to Revelation 13 with me, if you would. Revelation 13, and let's look here at this first beast. We went into this in great detail last night. If you missed last night, please, please, go and listen to this on last night's message on the website, or see if you can get a copy of it. Very, very important message. So, Revelation 13 and verse 1 and 2. And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and upon his heads 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like a leopard, his feet as the feet of a bear, his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Right here we see the seed of the serpent. This beast that comes up out of the sea. Wow. We studied that last night. Very, very powerful. By the way, we didn't go into it last time. We had a lot that we didn't get into. But notice this beast in Revelation 13. It comes up out of the sea. It's made up of the different body parts of the beasts of Daniel 7. We studied that last night. Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. Because this nation, and we found that a beast is a nation in Bible prophecy, this nation, okay, would draw its teaching from pagan ideas. And it would mingle them with Christian ideas. And that's exactly what happened to the Christian church during the Dark Ages. We found in Daniel chapter 7, there were 10 identifying marks of who the Antichrist was. Very, very clear. And one of those identifying marks we're going to look at more clearly tonight, he would think to change God's times and laws. Now, I don't know if you realize this or not, but there's only been one power, one nation, that has ever claimed the power and authority to change the Ten Commandments. Now, there's other religions and other nations that reject them, but there's only been one. We're going to look at that tonight. We found that it was the church of the Christian church of the Dark Ages. Now, Paul talked about this. John talked about this. All through the writings of the apostles, they warned that false teachers were going to come into the Christian church. He says, they said, as wolves in sheep's clothing. And so that began to happen, not during the apostles' time so much, but as the centuries went by, more and more false teaching came in, and then there was a Roman emperor named Constantine. And Constantine was the ultimate politician. He said, I want to unite in my empire, and I want to get at least 80 or 90% of the vote. And so he united paganism and Christianity together. It took hundreds and hundreds of years for the devil to do this. So God knows this has happened. It never was God's intention that there would be over 2,000 different churches all claiming to follow the Bible. That's confusion. And to everybody else in the world, it's confusion as well. And so before the end of time, God is going to bring his true people back together to be united, right? So we recognize that God has a message of warning. So turn to chapter 14 now, Revelation 13 and verse 14, and notice what this message of warning is. Chapter 14, and we're going to look here at this third angel to begin with. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 9. The third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if anyone worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. So here's this warning from God Almighty. And he says to anybody on planet Earth who's alive at the end of time, he says, if anyone worship the beast or this power or to take its mark or to worship its image, he says they're going to receive the full wrath of God. That's a very solemn warning. As a matter of fact, that's the most solemn warning you'll find anywhere in the Bible. Now, would God make this kind of a warning and not make it crystal clear who this power was? Of course not. Because God wants people in heaven more than they want to be there. But notice in verse 6 and 7, this is the first angel, and notice the first angel's message. I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those that dwell on the earth, to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. Okay, so there's a message from God to every single person as well. Verse 7, saying with a loud voice, fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come. We began studying that last night. And then he says, worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. So here, right at the end of time, to every single person on planet Earth, God gives this threefold message, and the message primarily deals with what? Worship. Worship. God says, listen, don't worship that beast that comes up out of the sea. Don't worship it. If you do worship it at the end of time, he says you're going to receive the wrath of God. But then he calls all the world through that first angel to worship the Creator. This is a quotation from the fourth commandment here in verse 7. Worship God. Why? Why should we worship Jesus Christ? Well, he's the one that created us. He's the one that died for us. He deserves our worship. You may not feel all warm and fuzzy some days, but he still deserves your worship. Amen? It may seem to me that God is not doing good by me on certain circumstances in my life, but he still deserves my worship. He's my creator, and he's the one who died on Calvary's cross. Folks, most people who go to church today are following their preachers, and they're following their religious leaders. But I want to tell you something. I don't care how good a preacher is. They didn't die for your sins. And I don't care how popular or powerful a religious leader is. They can't save you from sin. They're a sinner just like you are. I'm a sinner just like you. And I've said this over and over again. I need Jesus just as much as you. You see, it's God's word that we need in Jesus. And so God gives this great warning. And it has to do with worship. Now, this makes sense. Now, we're going to put a few things together here. Last night, one of the identifying marks of the Antichrist was he would think. Notice the Bible says he would think. Nobody can change God's law. God wrote it with his own finger on stone. Now, we have to recognize that God's law can't save people. God's law can't change people. God's law cannot heal people. But God's law reveals God's character. Praise the Lord. God's law reveals what love looks like. Okay? And so the Antichrist would think to change God's times and laws. Now let's think about it. Who's behind this Antichrist, this beast that comes up out of the sea? The dragon is, right? So what is, when Lucifer was in heaven, what did he turn his back on? God's law, right? Because he was one of the covering cherubs. And so we would expect him at the end of time to have a delusion and a deception for the whole world that would have to do with rejecting some part of God's law. We would expect that, and God gave us a heads up 2,500 years ago that that would take place. So let's think about this. One of the things we saw last night, one of the identifying marks of the Antichrist was that it would blaspheme God's name. What did we find out blasphemy was from the Bible? When a man, a human, claims to be God on earth, right? Or claims the power to forgive sin. That's blasphemy. Okay? And we found it right there from the Ferrari's Ecclesiastical Dictionary. The Pope is of so great authority and power, he is able to modify, declare, or interpret even divine law. You know, one thing I appreciate about the Catholic faith, because this isn't about people. What we're studying here is not about people. It's about systems that God said would arise and somehow try to deceive the world, right? But I appreciate about the Catholic faith, at least they're honest. They don't say they go by the Bible. They say they go by the traditions of the fathers or by the popes or whatever they decide. Now, I don't agree with that. That's not biblical, but at least they're honest. Okay? And so they believe that for a long time. Now, I'm going to show you something here very, very profound. Deep within the heart of God's law, there is a symbol of God's authority. Now, how does God rule the universe?
Through love.
Through love. Amen. God doesn't rule through force. Now, folks, God is ruling the universe and giving everyone an opportunity to decide for themselves who they're going to give their allegiance to. We're either going to give our allegiance to Jesus Christ and his government based on his law of love, or we're going to give our allegiance to Satan, who's working behind the world system, and we're going to be in rebellion against God. It's pretty simple. So, turning your Bibles now to the book of Exodus, the second book in the Bible, Exodus chapter 20. Exodus chapter 20. You know, one thing I've learned over the years, a lot of changes have come into the Christian churches over the last 50 years. I've got some perspective now. I'm not a kid anymore. But back 50 years ago, you can walk into any Christian church, and guess what you'd find somewhere in that church? You find a copy of the Ten Commandment Law of God. You would. But you won't find them anymore. You won't find them anymore. The devil has been working very, very subtly. So notice what this fourth commandment says. Here it is, Exodus chapter 20. I'm going to put it on the screen. Verse 8. God says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Folks, it is not the Jewish Sabbath. Okay? It's not your Sabbath or my Sabbath. It's God's Sabbath. And God said, remember it. He says, in it you shall not do any work. You, your son, your daughter, your manservant, your maidservant, your cattle, or your stranger is within your gates. Here it is, Revelation chapter 14, verse 7. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day, wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Now, when God said, remember, he was bringing the people backward to a time when he had created the Sabbath. So go back to Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2. Because remember, at the end of time, Satan is going to bring great deception in regard to worship, right? And regard to God's word. And so in Genesis chapter 2, we look in verses 1 through 3. This is the last, right at the end of creation, Genesis 2 and verse 1. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of them. How many days did it take God to create the earth? 6 days, okay? Verse 2. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. God was all tuckered out, right?
No.
So why did he rest? He had just created Adam and Eve, right? And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, the Bible tells us he created us for fellowship. And so God wasn't going to just check out and go to some other galaxy. He spent all that Sabbath with Adam and Eve, fellowshipping with them, sharing his heart with them, and beginning to show them who he really was. And so he rested from all his work, verse 3, and God blessed the seventh day, he sanctified it, because then he had rested from all his work which God created and made. And so the seven-day Sabbath exalts who? Jesus, as in what role?
Creator.
Okay. The seven-day Sabbath exalts Jesus as creator. Now, do you suppose the devil's happy about that?
No.
Absolutely not. Satan hates Jesus with a hatred that we can't even begin to comprehend. And he doesn't want Jesus to get any worship. He doesn't want Jesus to get any praise. Satan wants to get all the worship and praise for himself. And so Satan is determined that he will steal away the glory that is due to God Almighty. Very powerful how Satan is so evil. Now, we got to ask ourselves a question. Sometimes people say, well, you know, that seventh-day Sabbath, that was for the Jews. Now, folks, how many Jews were alive when Adam and Eve were on planet Earth? Mm-hmm. Now, last I checked, folks, there weren't any Jews for about 2,000 years. The Sabbath was not made for just Jewish people. Jesus wants a special relationship with all people, right? And he wants everyone to know him as creator and as Redeemer. Now, we're thinking about this beast that comes up out of the sea. We found it was the Christian Church of the Dark Ages. Here is quoting from one of their very reverend leaders, Father Enright. The Bible says, remember that you keep holy the Sabbath day. The Catholic Church says, no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. And lo, the entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the command of the Holy Catholic Church. Folks, that's powerful. This is a modern catechism, I'm quoting from right now. The civil authorities should be urged to cooperate with the church in maintaining and strengthening this public worship of God, and to support with their own authority the regulations set down by the church's pastor. You know who the Vatican's pastor is? The Pope, right? For it is only in this way that the faithful will understand why it is Sunday and not the Sabbath day that we keep holy. So God in Bible prophecy has revealed this incredible apostasy that would come into the Christian church during the Dark Ages. And if you're a Christian, it doesn't matter what church you attend. This has had a profound impact on you and on me. This is our history. Okay? And so we recognize this has happened. It's history. It's in the history books. But we want to go into it more deeply. We saw one of the identifying marks is that beast power would rule for 1,260 years or 42 prophetic months. And we found that time ended in 1798. That's when Napoleon's general, Pope Pius VI, took Pope Pius VI off the papal chair and imprisoned him in exile, and he died in exile. In 1798, it appeared at the Vatican. It's only 109 acres. I've been there. Just this tiny little place. 109 acres. That's a lot of land. But I mean, compared to most nations, okay? And so anybody who was a thinking person would have thought if they didn't study the Bible, that was it. They were done, right? But let's go back to Revelation chapter 13 now. Because in Revelation chapter 13, God gives us some more insight on what would happen to this Antichrist system. We read this last night, but it was very quickly. Revelation 13 and verse 3. Revelation chapter 13 and verse 3. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death. He received a mortal wound or a deadly wound. And his deadly wound, what does the Bible say would happen? Was healed. And then what does it say?
And
all the world, what does it say? Wow. Now the word wonder there, if you look it up in the concordance, in the Greek, means to blindly follow. So God is showing here in Bible prophecy, there would be a supernatural, who's behind this power? The dragon, right? A supernatural resurrection, not of a person, but of this system, that would become so powerful and so popular, it would command allegiance from how many? All the world. I don't hesitate to tell you that we're seeing that with our very eyes today. You know, Francis came to America, was it a year ago this past fall? Time goes so fast, it's amazing to me. And some of you might remember how much security he needed, right? Some of you may not have noticed that when he addressed all the people on the Washington Mall, some of you may not have noticed, but he was standing at the highest place in the Capitol building, higher than the President of the United States stands. That wasn't by accident. Showing the power and prestige of this system. Wow. You see, we're living in the fulfillment of these prophecies. And so, it's all recorded in history. 1929, Italy gave back to the Vatican the right to govern itself. And since that time, we've seen a rise in prestige and power. You know, in John Paul II, that we had three American presidents go and kneel down at his coffin. All the popularity, all these different incredible things that are happening. Okay? Now, we saw last night that this beast comes up out of the water. We found that the waters represent peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues. And so the Vatican, the papacy, arose from the center of civilization. So this first beast, or this first nation, is clearly revealed by the Bible. That it would raise itself for 1,260 years. It would have power. And by the way, during the Dark Ages, kings were cut off and excommunicated from the church if they didn't go along in every detail with what the Vatican wanted. Had total power. But then they would receive a deadly wound, 1798. The deadly wound would be healed, and then all the world would wonder after this power. It's all been taking place. Now we want to study tonight, who is this second beast? So we're in Revelation 13, and now we're going to go to verse 11. Revelation 13 and verse 11. Notice what it says. Actually, verse 10. Okay? Revelation 13 and verse 10. He that leads into captivity shall go into captivity. One of the identifying marks of the Vatican is it would persecute, right? But God said, he that leads into captivity shall go into captivity. When did the Vatican receive his deadly wound? 1798. It's all in the history books. So in 1798, when it was led into captivity, we see verse 11, another beast or another nation coming up. But this beast, this nation comes up out of the what? Earth. All the other beasts we've studied come up out of the sea. So we've already studied this first one, global religious control. Now we've got one that will exhibit global economic power at the end of time. Alright? So we're looking here. It comes up. As the first beast, verse 10, goes into captivity, this second beast comes up, 1798. Now I want us to do a little history lesson here about the United States tonight. 1776 is when we declared our independence. And every person who signed that document immediately was guilty of high treason against the British Crown. They could have lost their life at any time. They took a tremendous risk. For 7 long years, that Revolutionary War ground on. And if you study the Revolutionary War, there's no way that America had a chance of beating Britain. Britain was the most powerful nation in the world. It was the superpower of the world at that time. There's no way we had a ghost of a chance. But God in Bible prophecy said a nation would come up out of the earth, right? 1783, Yorktown. The war was over. But for 4 years, we were not a united states of America, still 13 colonies. But in 1798, the Constitution and the Bill of Rights were written up, and it took 2 years to ratify them. It's fascinating. If you study history, how independent, we think we're independent now in New England. Those, our forefathers and foremothers, they were extremely independent, and they were threatening each other not to sign or ratify those things. But finally, in 1798, they ratified the Constitution and Bill of Rights. But it wasn't until 1798 that the first other nation in the world sent an ambassador to the United States. No other nation in the world recognized America as a sovereign nation until France did it in 1798. Folks, that is not chance. The very exact year that the papacy was going into captivity, America was recognized on the world stage as a sovereign, independent nation. That's Bible prophecy. That's why I believe in the Word of God. Folks, I have no interest in following things that are not true. With all my heart, I've been studying this book 43 years. God's Word never fails. And so we see this nation coming up as the first one goes into captivity. The first one comes up from the sea. The sea represents a largely populated area. So the second one comes up out of the earth. What would it represent? A sparsely populated area. You go back to Genesis chapter 1, the first usage of the word earth in the Bible. And there's no population. So this second nation comes up somewhere on the planet that has not been heavily populated. There's only one place, the New World, at that time. And so we recognize that. It would arise in a relatively unpopulated area. It would be a young nation. When it says coming up there, the Greek word means to spring up gently as a plant. And here we have some historians. Like a silent seed, we grew into a nation, emerging and amid the silence of the earth, daily adding to its power and strength. All the other beasts of Bible prophecy, they rose to power by conquering other nations. Not this nation. It rose gradually over time, increasing in strength. And so God opened up a place for the vicious persecution in Europe during that time for people to come over here. Now, as we read in verse 11, notice this kingdom, the second beast, has two horns. And these horns are like, what does it say there? Like a lamb. Who does the lamb represent? It represents Jesus. And Jesus said in John chapter 8, verse 32 and verse 36, he says, "You shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free." So this second nation, these lamb-like horns, this nation would stand for liberty according to the symbols. But notice on these horns, there's no crowns. If you remember, that first beast had crowns on the horns. And those crowns indicate kingly authority. But there are no crowns on the horns of the second beast, and they're lamb-like. In other words, these two powerful principles that would govern this nation would not be governed by kingly power. Okay? Two horns like a lamb, it would stand for freedom. What are the only kinds of freedom that we have in our world? We have civil liberty for people to elect officials to govern the nation. And we have, what's the other kind of freedom? Religious liberty, where men and women and young people have freedom of conscience to serve God according to their own choice. Wow, what a portrayal of God raising up this mighty nation. A nation that would stand for civil liberty and religious freedom. By the way, it's not been our economic freedom that has been our greatest blessing and brought us so much prosperity, folks. It has been the religious liberty that we've enjoyed in this country for over 200 years. Wow, we are so blessed to be in this nation. My wife and I worked over in Romania for a whole year, back just after the fall of communism. And it was just very moving to me because I had always lived in America. In a whole year, and we mingled with the people there preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and these prophetic truths. And it was very moving for me because the people were still under the fear of communism. And they were still under the tradition and fear of the Greek church, not the Greek church, but the Romanian Orthodox Church. And I just saw how we take freedom, spiritual freedom, for granted in this country. We're so blessed to have that in this country. God foretold that that would happen in Bible prophecy. So horns are a symbol of power. They indicate that this second beast derives its power from political and religious freedom. There would be no kingly authority. Think of it. A nation without a king and a church without a pope. Back at that time, that was unheard of in the whole world. Very, very powerful. So what is the only nation, obviously, in the United States of America? Been to Plymouth Rock. If you've never been there, it'd be good to take some time to meditate upon how blessed we are. The sacrifice of those men and women who came there looking for religious freedom. And I have many quotations here. George Washington, every man conducting himself as a good citizen and being accountable to God alone for his religious opinions ought to be protected and worshiping the deity according to the dictates of his own conscience. Thomas Jefferson, Ulysses Grant, Benjamin Franklin, when religion is good, it will take care of itself. When it's not able to take care of itself and God does not see fit to take care of it, so that it has to appeal to the civil power for support, it's evidence in my mind that the cause is a bad one. True spiritual power can never be enforced by the government. Never can. It always causes persecution. And so we have privilege to live in this country. Now, let's notice. I wish we could end right here tonight, folks. But the Bible prophecy doesn't end there. Verse 11. Revelation 13, verse 11. I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb, and he spoke as a, what does it say?
Dragon.
Wow. In other words, God foretold this nation springing up slowly, quietly, would become a world-dominating superpower that would speak as a dragon. Who's the dragon? That's why this beast is called a false prophet in Bible prophecy. Revelation 19 makes that very clear. Because it has two horns like a lamb, it claims to stand for freedom, but it would become a persecuting power at the end of time. Now, verse 12. He, the second beast, exercises all the power of the first beast before him, the Vatican, and causes the earth and them that dwell therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. Here we see God revealing in Bible prophecy that America would come up, and what would it do? It would now use its power to what? To pressure and unite with the Vatican to force worship, worldwide worship. Now we're going to look at a few slides here to show how profound this is. How does a nation speak? It speaks through the laws of its legislative body. Very powerful. So here we just read, he exercises all the power of the first beast, and he causes those that dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. We see in Bible prophecy this right at the end of time, this union of America and the Vatican City. Notice any similarities there? All this, folks, this is not by chance. This was all planned out hundreds and hundreds of years ago. We see over these last 70 years now, every American president has to make a visit with the Pope. Some of you may remember under Ronald Reagan what happened back in the 1980s. Very fascinating. Yes. By the way, it's against our Constitution to favor any one religion. Okay? It's against our Bill of Rights. But during that time, Ronald Reagan says, you know what? We need to have an ambassador with the Vatican because we're working together to overthrow communism. Now, that sounds good on paper, right? And so they got it through the House and the Senate, and it passed overwhelmingly, and we sent our first ambassador there to the Holy See. And it came out in the Time magazine. I'll never forget that time. It was very, very profound. Some of you may remember there was an attempt, assassination attempt on both of these figures. Right? All there in the history books, and we keep going on, more and more presidents. Here is the first American, no, not the first, but one of the first, Thomas Meadley, I believe that the United States as the world's only superpower and the Holy See is the only worldwide political sovereignty have significant roles to play in the future. It was like he was reading out of Revelation 13. Their actions will impact the lives of people in all parts of the globe. Now, George W. Bush had a real love for John Paul II. And he spoke, they were dedicating John Paul II, a cultural center there in Washington, D.C., and he spoke at that, and he had some very interesting words to say, but at the end of his talk, this is what he said. The best way to honor Pope John Paul II, truly one of the great men, is to take his teachings seriously, is to listen to his words and put his words and teachings into action here in America. This is a challenge we must accept. 1960, John Kennedy, most of you don't remember that. I do. In 1960, John Kennedy went from Washington down to Texas to assure Protestant preachers that he would not obey the Pope. In 2001, George Bush came from Texas up to Washington to assure a group of Catholic bishops that he would. Times have changed so rapidly in this world. It's amazing. We see him giving him the Medal of Freedom, President Obama. And so, folks, our nations are closer than ever before. We're living in the last moments of Earth's history. Now, somebody, you may be feeling very angry, very upset, and saying, well, you know, that I know that Francis is a very, very godly man, is he? Now, again, God loves Pope Francis as much as he loves me, but he's just another person, folks. He's not the vicar of God. He's not God on earth. Very, very important to understand.
He wants to take his place. That's what he wants.
That's true. But I want to share something with you. Every time a person bows down and calls him Holy Father, never once has he rebuked that person and told them to worship God. For God alone deserves our worship. Okay? When John was receiving the vision in Revelation, John fell down to worship a sinless angel, and the angel yanked him up off his feet and says, don't worship me, worship God alone. Now, if we really take Jesus' counsel seriously in the Gospels, Jesus said there would be false prophets and false Christs, okay, and they would have great power. So if Satan is going to deceive the world, he's not going to come as a raging lunatic. He's going to come as a person that looks so loving and so good. But what has this system done? They've tried to change God's times and laws, and they boast about it. They're very honest about it. Now, notice how this is going to happen. This final, it hasn't happened yet. The mark of the beast has not been enforced. By the way, tomorrow night, we're going to be studying the seal of God. The only people who will not be deceived by the mark at the end will be those who have the seal of God in their forehead. You don't want to miss tomorrow night if you're really serious about studying the Word. But I want us to think about it. How is Satan going to move this country from having this real close relationship between the Vatican and the United States? How is he going to move it to the next level to gain control over worship? How is he going to do it? The Bible tells us. Look at chapter 13. Notice what it says in verse 13 and 14. It's very clear. Revelation 13, verse 13. And he does great wonders so that he makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men and deceives them that dwell on the earth by the means of those what? What does it say? Miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had a wound, by a sword, and did live. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image should be killed. Folks, the thing that's going to move us to the final events are supernatural miracles that the masses will readily receive over the word of God. I don't hesitate to tell you tonight that more and more people will not even go to church unless it's based on emotion. Where are the days where the Word of God was preached and people would tremble in their seats under the holiness of God Almighty? Where are those days? God is wanting us to realize He loves us, but He is sovereign creator and ruler of the universe. He can't take you or me into His kingdom if we have rebellion in our heart and we say, you know what, God, I see what your will is, I see your law, but I'm not willing to honor it. The devil's deceptions are becoming so great that many are being taught that grace destroys or sets aside the law of God. Have mercy. Folks, God's grace puts the law in our mind and in our heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. God's grace is not an emotion. It is the divine power and righteousness of God Himself given to us through Jesus. And so when we receive Jesus and His grace, God changes our heart and writes His law there. The law never saves us. Jesus saves us, but He puts it there. So how is this going to happen? These incredible miracles. Now, in the Bible, fire has been used in a number of circumstances. Then the day of Pentecost, when the disciples were praying in the upper room, they were praying with the Holy Spirit. And what does the Bible say? Tongues of fire came down from heaven on them, and God filled them with the Holy Spirit. But according to what we're reading here, there's going to be a false, counterfeit, supernatural outpouring of spiritual power that will move the masses to go along and reject God's law. Wow, very powerful. But there's something even more. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles, back to the book of 1 Kings in the Old Testament. Because in the Bible, there was a time where the issue was settled by God by fire coming down from heaven. So you may remember that if you studied your Bible very much. 1 Kings 18. Notice what it says. 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 21. God's people had been worshiping false gods. And the main god they were worshiping was Baal. Okay? It was a heathen god. Very sensual worship. They were worshiping Baal, and God says there's no dew or no rain coming on Israel until He gave His word. And so that time came, and so they were all assembled there on Mount Carmel. In 1 Kings 18, verse 21, Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long do you halt between two opinions? What's God saying at the end of time? You're going to make a decision one way or the other, right? So here's fire falling from heaven. It's not from God in Revelation, right? It's these great miracles to deceive the masses to go along with this one world order. So Elijah said, how long will you halt between opinions? If the Lord, that's Yahweh, the true God, if He be God, follow Him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. Then Elijah, and he goes on to say what they did. And so they had two altars. And they killed two bullocks. And they put them on those two altars. One for Baal, one for God. And so Elijah said very graciously, okay, you and your prophets of Baal, you can go first. If you studied this story all morning long, they danced and they shouted and they cut themselves dancing around that altar. Oh, Baal, hear us. No fire came. Now, do you suppose the devil was there and wanted to send fire on that altar? You better believe it, folks. He was there because he hated Elijah. He was a man of God. He was teaching the people the truth about the true God and true worship. But God prevented Satan from bringing the fire. And then at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Elijah said, you know what? Maybe your God's asleep. Maybe he's out on vacation, you know, sporting above. And then he had a humble prayer. He said, God, please hear me. And fire came down from God out of heaven, and God only burnt up the sacrifice, it burned up the stones and burnt up the water all around that sacrifice. Powerful. Now, hang on for this. Hang on for this. In the last days, remember, Revelation is largely symbolic. There is going to be this great challenge at the end between true worship, right? But at the end of time, God is not going to restrain the fire from coming to deceive the masses. Hang on for that. Think about that. God is going to allow his people at the end of time, those who really love him, to be loyal to him for one reason alone. Because they accept what God's word says. Wow. How many today, even in church, are earnestly searching the scriptures to know the truth and accept it into their heart by faith? Few folks. Few. Now I'm going to show you now from the Bible what that fire represents. Turn with me, if you would, over to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10. Because Jesus nailed this symbol and gave us this inspired understanding of this fire falling down. This is not a literal altar at the end of time. It's not a literal fire coming from heaven at the end of time. Okay? Notice what he's saying here, Luke 10 and verse 18. This is Jesus speaking. Luke chapter 10 and verse 18. And Jesus said unto them, I beheld Satan as, what does it say? Lightning fall. As you study the Gospels, Jesus warned over and over again of false Christ at the end of time. Folks, at the end of time, God is going to allow Satan to come. This is before probation closes. God is going to allow Satan to come and personate, who do you suppose he's going to personate? Christ. Jesus Christ himself. And the masses are going to believe it's Jesus. And what do you suppose the devil is going to be teaching? The same things he's been teaching for thousands of years. And he's going to be convincing the masses through miracles, supernatural miracles, that the law of God has been changed. And God's times and laws have been changed. And that the world needs to unite and honor the Bishop of Rome and the Vatican and go along with this one world order. You say, how do you know that? Turn over to 2 Corinthians, if you would, chapter 11. Paul nails this. He makes it crystal clear that Satan is going to come as an angel of light. 2 Corinthians 11, verses 13 through 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13, right after Acts, Romans, Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 11, verse 13. He says, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. And if we think Francis is smooth, wait till the devil comes as Jesus. I'm telling you, folks, people are going to feel better than they ever felt in their life. They're going to be all over the world. Some, they'll be watching on the internet. They'll be watching on satellite. Some of them will flop around. And they're going to be swallowing everything he says. Now, what do you suppose the devil is going to be speaking? He's going to be speaking truth. But he's also going to be speaking lies with his team. And when Satan tempted Jesus, he quoted Scripture. Matthew chapter 4. He quoted Scripture when he was tempting Jesus. But he left out part of that Scripture. In other words, he misquoted. He twisted the Word of God. He used the Word of God to tempt Jesus, but he twisted it. But thank God, Jesus said, he saw it. He saw it. He says, it is written. Most God's people at the end of time are going to stand upon God's Word and God's Word alone, and they're going to honor God's law. Not in order to be saved, because nobody can be saved through their own works. But they're going to honor God's law because they've fallen in love with Jesus. And they've been filled with the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God will be putting his laws in their minds, in their hearts. And they will be loyal to Jesus no matter what the cost. Oh, my dear brothers and sisters, we're living in that time. God himself, we're going to study on this tomorrow night some more. God is holding back this final delusion. That will be the overwhelming delusion. God's holding them back. He's trying to help you and I, anybody who's willing to dig into the Word and understand what's coming. And so here we see over in the Vatican City on one of their high altars, the symbols of Baal. I don't have time in this short seminar, but I've got literally hundreds and hundreds of slides showing that the whole Vatican City is based on pagan sun worship with a Christian veneer. It's amazing. And so at the end of time, God is going to allow Satan to come as Jesus with all of his supernatural power to deceive anybody who's not willing to stand on the word of God. Wow. Boy, what a time we're living in. So church and state will unite to enforce religious practices. But God says, do not follow a multitude to do evil. Don't try to judge if something's true or not by the masses, folks. Study it out for yourself. Open the Bible and search the word of God. The stage has already been set. And we see it all over. Just this last week, at the end of the 500-year Protestant Reformation, it's been washed away. It's been signed away by the masses. The unity is in full blast. I have so many slides. We don't have time to read them all. All these different religions, all these different ones. And the push is honor a pagan day of worship. Wow. Closer. So what's going to prevent God's end time people from being deceived? We're going to start to wind down and turn over with me, if you would, in the Bible to the book of Revelation. I want you to go to chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7. And notice what it says in verses 1 through 3. Revelation chapter 7, verses 1 through 3. See, so many people today are caught up in politics. They keep thinking that whoever's the president and whoever's in office is going to straighten out our country. Folks, they're just the little guys. Okay? There's a lot bigger things that are going on. It's just amazing. Chapter 7, Revelation verse 1. After these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow in the earth, nor the sea, nor in any tree. So notice here, these four angels holding the four winds, they're holding back this final crisis. They're holding back this final deception. They're doing it in love. Folks, as we sit here tonight, our God is in agony. He sees and feels the pain of the sin of the whole world today. He's in agony, but they're holding him back. For what purpose? Not so you can get a better job. Not so you can get a better house. Not so you can get a better car. Not so you can advance yourself. They're holding him back. It says in verse 2, I saw another angel ascend from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their forehead. Oh, folks, that's what God, in mercy, he's held back this final great deception and crisis for one reason. So you and I, anybody who's willing, could have the seal of God. That's the single most important thing, folks, that we need at this time. Wow. Tomorrow night we're going to study that. It's going to be so clear. It's going to be so powerful. So beautiful. Right out of the Word of God. And so God in His mercy. Now notice His people here. Chapter 12, now verse 17. Here it is. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. Revelation 12, verse 17. We're winding down. Revelation 12, 17, the dragon was wroth with the woman. The dragon is the devil. We've seen that. The woman is the church. We haven't studied that yet. And he went to make war with the remnant of her seed. That's the last part. God's last day people here. Verse 17. Notice it says here. It says they're keeping the commandments of God. And what else does it say? They have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So this sealing that God is doing on his servants, he's sealing his law. He's sealing his character in their foreheads. And notice what they're standing on. They're standing on the testimony of Jesus. And as we studied opening day, you're holding it in your hand. That's why they won't be deceived at the end of time. Everything they believe, they're going to find it right in this book. Everything they practice, it's right here. They believe in the real Jesus. Folks, you cannot believe in the real Jesus and reject what the real Jesus says. You can't do it. You can't do it. And so there they are. Last verse. Turn to Isaiah, the Old Testament, chapter 8 and verse 20. This is very, very simple. It's what we just read in Revelation, but I want you to see it in Isaiah. Isaiah, right there about halfway through your Bible. Isaiah chapter 8 and verse 20. Notice what the Bible says here. Isaiah 8:20. Yeah, the Bible says, it's on this screen, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. Oh, my dear friends, now is our appointed time by God himself. You know, God chose for you to be alive at the end of time. He's given you, he's given me, he's given us the greatest privilege of anybody who has ever lived. He's given us the greatest privilege. He's given us the privilege of being his witnesses in his judgment, that we can speak and live in favor of God and his truth. This is the greatest privilege. The God's people at the end of time will be the witness, the testimony, the evidence, as we read there last night in 1 Peter, the evidence to the whole universe that God is worthy of our love and probation. You know, as we close tonight, I know your life is busy. And I know that every one of us, and I put myself in that list, every one of us need a much deeper outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Every one of us need a deeper understanding of the Word of God. And so I want to plead with you, don't let anything or anyone keep you from studying and following God's precious Word. As we close, and I invite you to bow your head right where you are, just close your eyes. We're going to have a special time to make a decision for Jesus. Father in heaven, we've studied some very profound and clear, powerful prophecy tonight. Right out of your word. It's all coming to pass just the way you said. And Lord, tonight, you've made it clear. It's like you've given us the enemy's battle plan. You made it clear 2,500 years ago and everything you've written since that time that Satan would seek to change your times and laws. He hates your Sabbath, God, because he knows it exalts you and honors you and lifts you up as creator. He's brought in the teaching of evolution. He's brought in atheism and brought in every conceivable thing to dishonor you, Jesus. But Jesus, we want to thank you that you are the Lamb of God that bears away the sin of the world, our sin, anybody's sin, who's willing to respond to you. Jesus, you're inviting us to worship you because you're the creator at the end of time. You've made it clear in the Bible how you are calling us to do that, to honor your authority and embrace your beautiful gift of your Sabbath. Lord, I'm sad of all the people I've heard over the years, even people that go to church, who tear down and put down your seventh-day Sabbath. It's painful to me. How could a born-again Christian not rejoice and praise you for such a wonderful gift? And Lord, I thank you that we have a more sure word of prophecy. And so tonight, with our eyes closed, when you say to Jesus, Lord, I'm choosing to surrender my heart fully to Jesus and to Jesus' word, the word of God, tonight. Just raise your hand wherever you are. That's your choice. I surrender to you, Jesus, and to your word, all of your truth. Put your hand down, God. See those hands. God sees those hands. And Lord, I want to thank you so much that you made it clear. It's as clear a child can see these things. I thank you you've made it clear that you've given us such a wonderful Savior, such a wonderful Creator who is willing to be treated the way we deserve. Not so we can continue to break your law, but you've been treated the way we deserve, Jesus, so we can be forgiven. And you can put your laws into our minds and into our hearts. What a beautiful gift the new covenant is, Lord. And we praise you for its power and the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray you'll help us to go home quietly tonight as we treasure these thoughts and these beautiful, precious Bible passages we've studied tonight. And Father, I pray you'll bring us back together tomorrow night. If we know anybody who has an interest at all in understanding these things, help us to invite them. We're very blessed to study these things tonight. We thank you. We pray you'll keep each person safe. And we praise you for your wonderful grace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. I love you all. I'll see you tomorrow night. Don't miss it.